What then? Israel has not obtained what it seeks, but the elect have obtained it, and the rest were blinded, just as it is written. God has given them a spirit of stupor, eyes that they should not see, ears that they should not hear, to this very day. And David said, let their table become a snare and a trap, a stumbling block, and a recompense to them. Let their eyes be darkened so that they do not see, and bow down their back always. And bow down their back always. We'll stop right there, and may the Lord bless the reading and preaching of his word. We've been going through the book of Romans, and Paul is writing to the church there at Romans. He's writing to the Jews and to the Israelites. He's letting them know that just because God chose them and gave them the Ten Commandments, that they still had to trust in God. And he gives the plan of salvation. When we lead somebody to the Lord, we go over to Romans 3:23. And I've got these highlighted and read in my Bible. It says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And he's letting them know, just because God chose you to give you the Ten Commandments, just because you're the chosen nation to represent me here on this earth to all the other nations, you still have to get saved. And he says, righteousness comes through faith, and everybody has fallen short of the glory of God. Nobody can get to heaven just by doing good. Nobody can get to heaven by paying money. Nobody can get to heaven by helping an old lady cross the street. You have to get saved. He said, everybody has sinned. Is there anybody in here that has never sinned? Let me see your hand. We don't have any, do we? We have all sinned. And then you go over to Romans 6:23. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. And he's letting them know, just because you're chosen, just because God did all this, you still have to get saved. Nobody gets a free ticket to heaven. You have to get saved. He said everybody has sinned, so therefore there had to be an atonement made for that sin. Who came and died on the cross and shed their blood so we could have that atonement? Jesus did. And he died to bridge that gap so that we can get to heaven, but we have to go through Jesus. So therefore, he says, everybody has sinned. There's none righteous, no, not one. And the wages of sin is death. Now, when you work for somebody all week, they give you wages, right? Now, do they just arbitrarily give you something without you giving something in return? Well, nowadays, yes, maybe. But if somebody works for you, you pay them, right? If they work. If they don't show up for work, guess what? You don't pay them, do you? You know? But you get paid from the wages of sin by death. So therefore, something had to happen. Jesus had to come. He had to die on the cross. And the Jews, the Israelites, have rejected Jesus Christ. And Paul writes the whole book of Romans to let them know, hey, Jesus came and died. He is the Messiah. He is the answer to all the prophecies in the Old Testament. So therefore, you have to trust in him. They're still waiting on Jesus to come. They don't believe that Jesus was the Messiah. There's a few, and Paul brings that out. He says, there's a remnant. Those are the elect. God chose them and brought them in. So he is saying to the Jews, quit rejecting Jesus Christ. And he says, God's not cast them away. They're still the chosen people. And he says, I'm still an Israelite. I'm still a Jew. He says, you know, over in Philippians and Colossians and Ephesians, he says, I'm a Hebrew of Hebrews. I'm of the tribe of Benjamin. He had bragging rights. And if you were from the tribe of Benjamin, that was the baddest tribe, you know? They were the cool dudes. They were the one. And he says, I'm from that group. And he says, y'all don't have any bragging rights like I do. But he said, I still put my faith in Jesus Christ. And also in Romans, he went through and he talks about
them having faith. They put faith in the law. They put faith in their works. But he's telling them, you have to have faith in Jesus Christ. He talks about grace. He lets them know that it is by grace we are saved, not of works, lest any man should boast. You see, they thought they just had it. They thought they could just show up to heaven and God was going to let them in without them doing anything just because they kept the law. And Paul is letting them know that there's this thing called grace. Okay? You see, because everybody has sinned, because the wages of sin is death, he sent Jesus to die on the cross for us and to give us that grace. And that grace is his riches and mercy when we don't deserve it. And he's saying that you have to turn to Jesus, quit following the law, quit doing all that, and putting your faith and trust in the law, and put your faith and trust in Jesus Christ. And we have to do the same thing. We put faith in everything else but Jesus Christ, don't we? We put faith in the television. We put faith in the checkbook. We put faith in our job. We put faith in our spouse. And there's nothing wrong with putting faith in things like that. You put faith in your vehicle to get here this morning, right? You jumped in that truck or car and you put that key in the ignition and you just had faith that it was going to crank up. Did anybody not crank up and have to get another vehicle to come or to get jumped off? You had pretty good faith this morning, didn't you? You put the key in to crank right up. That's faith. You had faith in them pews. When you sat down, you put your faith in that pew that it was not going to crash and drop you. Okay? And he is saying you're putting your faith in the wrong things. And I'm telling us, sometimes we put our faith in the wrong thing. And it should be in Jesus Christ. And he's letting the Jews know, I'm a Jew too, he said. And I know what you're going through. He said, I studied the law. I was the best Jew there ever was. He said, so much, I was so zealous, I went out killing Christians because I thought they were coming against God. He said, I thought I was doing God a favor. But he said, I had my faith in the wrong thing. And he's letting them know, and you can talk to an Orthodox Jew today, and they'll tell you that their faith is in the law and keeping their certain rituals that they do, and that's going to get them into heaven. And Paul is saying, no, it's not. And he's saying, I was one of you and I was doing all that, but it's wrong and you got to stop it. You got to put your faith in Jesus Christ. And then last week we looked at, he said, if you would just repent of your sin and confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus Christ and believe that he raised from the dead, you might be saved, right? Is that what he said? You might be saved? What did he say? He says, you will be saved. And you say, you see, their salvation was in doing all the rituals and the law and everything. And Paul says, no way. And he says, God hasn't rejected the Jews. And you go all through the Old Testament, they're God's chosen people. God has a plan for the nation of Israel, for the Jews, the true Jews. That's why he brings out about being of the seed of Abraham, because Abraham is the father of the Jews. You go back to Genesis chapter 12, and it'll tell you how God told him to get up and get out of the Ur of the Chaldees where he was living and go to a land that he would show them, and it would be the promised land, a land flowing with milk and honey. And so Abraham did that, and that's where the Jews started from. And all through the Old Testament, it talks about how the Jews are God's chosen people. But you see, God was a little bit too good to have. Have you ever had a child or a grandchild or somebody that you just spoiled them and you kept spoiling them? And you kept spoiling them. And because you spoiled them so much, you couldn't get them to do anything. Have you ever seen anybody like that? That's the way the Jews were. God just spoiled them and spoiled them and spoiled them. Because they were his chosen people. But now Paul's coming along and saying, because you were spoiled so bad, and you put all your faith in all the wrong things, you've got to stop that. Folks, like I told you last week, there's only one way to heaven, and that's through Jesus Christ. Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. So we kind of reviewed the history of the Jews. But now, he says, I'm not rejecting them. He says, there is a remnant. He said he foreknew them. And he chose them. And he is going to take care of them. When all this plays out, he still has a special place for those people. But because they rejected Jesus, the Bible says in John, he came to his own and his own received him not. But because they rejected Jesus, his plan was not going to be able to be carried out through the Jews. So therefore, Jesus died on the cross and shed his blood, and then the church was born. You had the disciples, and then they became the apostles, and they started going around planting churches, getting people together. You see, they used to meet in synagogues, and they would carry out their rituals. And these disciples and then apostles started saying, that's all wrong. We worship Jesus because he died for us on the cross. And so therefore they went around planting churches. And Paul, because the Jews rejected him and rejected Jesus Christ, God said, leave the Jews alone and go over here and start telling the Gentiles about my son Jesus Christ. Start churches and get them worshiping Jesus. So that's what he did. And he started planting churches all throughout the land over there. And he brings up Elijah. What does he say about Elijah? Elijah was a prophet. And he says, the Jews have rejected your prophets. And he brings out Elijah as an illustration. And he said, Elijah was there and he thought he was all alone. And, you know, he went up to King Ahab and he said, King, if you don't get right, if your wife Jezebel don't get right, it's not going to rain for 3.5 years. So it didn't rain for 3.5 years. And they were hunting Elijah and going to kill him because, you know, he prayed and it stopped raining. But then it finally came down to the duel there on Mount Carmel. They were worshiping Baal. The Jews had turned from God and were worshiping all of these false idols, false gods and everything. And so finally Elijah said, enough is enough. Let's have a meeting. We're going to have a showdown. And whoever God answers by fire, that's who we're going to serve. So all the Baal priests got out there. They were dancing and cutting themselves and hooping and hollering and praying that fire, that Baal would send fire. Nothing. And Elijah was over there taunting. What's the matter? Is Baal asleep? Maybe he's out back relieving himself. You know, and he kept on just taunting and taunting. So then it became Elijah's turn. And y'all know the story. I've preached on it before. He took a bull, he cut it up, and he laid it in pieces. And first he repaired the altar where they used to worship Jehovah God. And he repaired that, and he laid the sacrifice up there. And remember, it hadn't rained for 3.5 years. There was a bad drought going on. And so he says, dump some water on it. So they dumped 12 barrels of water on it. And then he said, do it again. They did that 4 different times. And then he started praying. He said, God, these people are worshiping Baal. They've missed the boat. They're doing it wrong. And we want to serve you. And whoever God answered by fire, that's who we're going to serve. So please send fire. And fire fell from heaven and consumed the sacrifice and the water that was all over it and in the trenches and everything. And so Elijah gathered up all the prophets of Baal and he killed them. And trying to get the Israelites to see, you need to come back, you need to worship God. That's kind of what Christians do in the world today, right? We go out
and we talk to people, and people that ain't doing right, people that are sinning, and people that have never accepted Jesus Christ, and we try to get them to come over and be saved and start worshiping God. You see, you go out in the world, you worship all kinds of things, drugs, alcohol, all kinds of junk. But all it's going to lead you to is sorrow and misery. Okay? If you don't put Jesus Christ first, you're going to be miserable. I don't care. It doesn't matter what you put your faith in. If it's not in Jesus, you're going to be miserable. I've lived the life. I know. You can put your faith in money. You can put your faith in drugs. You can put your faith in alcohol. Whatever you want to. You can play all the games you want to. But until you accept Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, you're going to be miserable. And to sum all of this up, that's what Paul was trying to tell the Jews. You know, like we, you know, go out and do the drugs and alcohol and put our faith in all the wrong things. They were doing it with their law and their rituals and stuff like that. Same thing. And Paul was telling them, and he uses Elijah as an illustration. He's saying you need to come back to where you used to be, because Israel used to worship God. They worshiped the one true Jehovah God. But then they strayed. Have you ever known somebody that kind of strayed? How many of you have ever strayed? I've strayed. You know, we've all strayed, haven't we? But folks, we got to come back. And until we get back to serving Jesus Christ like He wants us to, we're going to be miserable. And I don't care what your faith is in, it ain't going to get you to heaven. The only true faith is faith in Jesus Christ. And that's the whole first 10 chapters right there. And now He's telling them, you need to come on back. Okay? And I'm telling you, if you're out there straying, you need to come on back. And what does He say? He says, I've reserved a remnant. You're not the only one, Elijah. Remember, Elijah went and sat up under the tree and said, oh God, kill me. Jezebel's trying to kill me and all, and I'm running for my life, and I'm in fear of my life, so therefore just kill me. And He sends Elijah. He says, son, you're missing the boat. The Jews are missing the boat, now you're missing the boat. He says, I have reserved 7,000 that has not bowed their knee to Baal. Okay? And He says, at this present time, there is even a remnant. You know, it kind of seems like the whole world has gone to hell. Would you agree with me on that? Seems like the whole world has gone to hell. The whole world is doing everything but worshiping God. We've tried kicking God out of schools. We've tried kicking Him out of the courthouses. We've quit worshiping Him. We quit serving Him. We quit going to church. But guess what? It doesn't matter how bad it gets, God is still going to have a few that's going to serve Him no matter what. No matter what. Paul says, I'm one of them that's going to serve Him no matter what. And y'all need to come back and start doing that too. Maybe there's someone here today, you've been out there in the world. You're trying all this other stuff. You've strayed, and you need to come on back. Maybe you've never accepted Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior. You need to come get saved. He says all you got to do is repent of your sin, because what did He say? All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Everybody has. And if you're short of the glory of God, that means that you need to get in a position where you can receive that glory. And He says, because everybody has sinned, and because the payment for sin is death, you got to do something. And He says that in 10, 9 and 10. He says, whoever confesses with their mouth the Lord Jesus Christ, they're the ones that are going to be saved. And if you've never confessed with your mouth the Lord Jesus Christ and believe that He died on the cross and rose again on the third day, then you're lost. That's just plain and simple. You're lost. And you need to be saved before it's too late. So Paul is pleading with the Jews. And he's letting them know, And we read last week, he said, my heart's desire is that I would lose my own salvation so that you would get saved. He was burdened for his own people. Are we burdened for our people? I don't think we are. Oh, we may have a little bit of concern, but we're really not burdened. You know what really being burdened for somebody is? It's like holding somebody under the water and them wanting air. And you keep holding them under there. And when they finally come up or you let them up or whatever, they go, oh. You know, that's kind of what a burden is. Paul had that burden for his people. We need to have that burden for the lost people around us, for our family, for our friends, our co-workers. That's why Paul is pleading with the Jews. Quit putting your faith in the law. Quit putting your faith in the rituals. Come over and serve Jesus Christ. And I'm telling you, quit putting your faith in the world. Quit putting your faith in your money. Quit putting your faith in your work. Quit putting your faith in everything else. And come over and put your faith in Jesus Christ. It'll be the best thing we ever did. I promise you that. So as the ladies come, we're going to have a hymn of invitation. And the invitation is very simple. If you need to be saved, you need to come on down. I'll take the scripture and show you how that you can be saved. Jesus says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have eternal life. And you have that eternal life by asking him in your heart, believing in your heart. So maybe you need to be saved, you need to come on. Maybe you strayed away like the Jews, maybe you need to come back. Maybe you need to come to the altar and pray. Maybe you need to be prayed with. I'll pray with you, you'll come down. Maybe you just need to go to somebody and have them pray with you or talk to them or something. I don't know. But if God is burdening your heart to do something, please be obedient. What number are we going to sing?
Page 279.
Hymn number 279. As you stand.